Forget everything that you think you know about comics. Some say the battle of good versus evil is never ending because evil always survives. Some say that there are two types of people in this world, those who drink beer and those who enjoy a good comic. But damn it, we are the bridge. And to that we say cheers. We are your guardians, your watchful protectors from everything mundane. Because in the real world, you either die a hero or you drink long enough to see yourself become the villain. There's a war going on out there. How can you be sure you're on the right side? The ageless debate of what's right and wrong brought to your headphones with the simplest of solutions. With great beer comes great responsibility. And we accept that responsibility. For in brightest day, in blackest night, no evil shall escape our sight. We are Hop Heroes, bringing the relevance of great beer and comic book stories to life.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Hop Heroes, the show where we talk about our favorite drinks and our favorite heroes. I'm your host, Jordan Aerith, and with me as always, we have the talented, the artistic, the... looks like he's getting ready to go into a boxing match. J.R. Gonzalez, how you doing, kid?
Pretty good. How are you doing?
I'm fucking exhausted.
That's good. You know,
it's been 2 weeks.
It has been 2 weeks.
It's been two weeks, man.
I saw a sunset the other day that reminded me of you, so I was pretty sad.
I was gonna say it's been two sleepless weeks because I've missed.
Yeah. So I mean, that sunset was just out of this world. But
what about it reminded you of me?
Just the brightness. You know, it was so adorable, and you know, it reminded me of your hugs that swallow me in. Because I'm half the body of your body, height and everything.
I'm almost there. Keep going.
So no, I'm done. I'm just gonna blue ball you. Or blue balling. You ruin it. Take it too far.
Yeah. Yeah, I do that. It's kind of on brand. I miss you too, man. No, we weren't able to drop an episode last week. I was in Montana.
Life.
At a softball tournament. My older brother's team played in this tournament, and it was a softball tournament, and it was also a drinking tournament. So Basically, you can't bring coolers in the stadium, so you have to buy all the beer at this Bud Light trailer, and every time you buy a beer, you just tell them what team you're from, and they tally it up, and whoever has the most tallies at the end of the tournament wins a big fucking trophy. And so that was why I was there. I was the drinking team. I hit once, and I popped up to shortstop, so my softball game was not prominent, but we won the beer tournament. We got fourth in softball and first in drinking by a landslide. We set a tournament record with 311 Bud Lights in 3 days.
Wow.
And second place had like 130, I think. So it was just a fucking bloodbath of shotgunning Bud Lights. So that was my last weekend, so that's why we weren't able to record. And I'm never – Montana's beautiful. Never fucking driving there again. That was the
– That is a hard drive.
Not a fan. And then this week, I was just at a wedding yesterday, and this was my first time being the plus one at a wedding where you know nobody else. Have you ever been in that position?
Yes. Amber and I, yes. It's not fun.
I thought it was a blast because you just get to make a whole new first impression with all these people. Everybody's in a good mood, so they're all talkative. There's open bar. Like, I love the people, like, meeting all these people and just kind of figuring out what their lives are. I told everybody I went to Yale and I was a rocket scientist.
Oh, okay. Scientist, yeah. I guess lying will help. No,
I didn't.
That's only fun if you're social. Like, I'm not social. So, you know, I'm like, oh, let's go hit the, you know, the food tray and stand there for like 20
minutes.
Let's
go hit the food tray, JR. We've hit it 5 times. Yeah. All right. You're going to sit in your seat.
And then you debate, should I get up again? You know, then you're like talking to your child. Oh, no, that's got, you know, and so it's just not fun for me. But, you know, I'm not a social, social person.
Well, you got to lubricate up the old confidence there with some alcohol.
I guess the real story is, how were you a plus one, and who was your other person that you went with?
Oh, I went with my friend Whitney. She had a friend of hers, obviously, was getting married, that she actually went to hip-hop dance class with. That's how they met, which is hilarious because they're the whitest girls you'll ever see. she just needed a date, you know, and she asked if I wanted to go. So,
oh, nice.
It was fun. It was a good time. Out in Woodinville at a winery.
Yeah.
And speaking of Woodinville, the beer on on tap today is actually out of Woodinville and Redmond from Black Raven. So we'll talk about that here in a second. But what have you been up to these past 2 weeks?
Let's see. Last weekend was my birthday, so it was a birthday weekend. So Amber and I just hang out and watched Black Widow, of course, and ate out, spent a lot of money, and I just kind of got to... I really haven't had a birthday weekend in a long time, like where it was literally just the whole weekend of things that I kind of wanted to do. So I just listened to 90s music the whole time, 90s music the whole weekend. And besides Black Widow, and I just got to hang out with my wife. I mean, nothing more important than that for me.
That's sweet. Mm-hmm. That's precious. Mm-hmm. And that's love.
That is.
Well, happy birthday, man.
Oh, thanks.
And happy to be back. Yeah. So, this week's episode, we're talking Black Widow. We're also talking Loki.
Yeah.
We've had 2 weeks of data to kind of fill in. And we're not talking Loki alone. We're talking Loki with our good friend Thomas Kellogg. TK Ukulele is coming on board because he has some thoughts and some feelings about the show. So he'll be on a little later. Before we get to that, let's go to the beverage breakdown. All right, so today we are doing Trickster IPA from Black Raven Brewing, which is pretty fitting, if you ask me, for the god of mischief, Loki. I've had this beer before. We actually did an episode on this beer back in the day that never made it to air. I think it was a Joker story. It was the one we did at my condo in Spanaway. You remember that?
Oh.
And we had to, like, re-record
that's
it.
That's right, where the cat jumped up on the monitor, and we're like, perfect. Yeah, that's, yeah.
Yeah, that's great audio. So, yeah, that. So this is our second time doing this beer. So I've had it before, and honestly, I've never been a huge fan, but it's been a while since I've tried it, so.
I've had Black Raven as well.
You have?
Yeah.
Did you just text me not to forget the picture?
Yes.
Yep. Every time I'm mid-drink, you get a text from JR. Don't forget to take a picture. I got a sixer of it, so.
Oh, okay, good.
We got options. But from the color, it looks pretty light. It doesn't look like the IPA that you usually see. It looks almost like a lager.
It's almost orange, or is that just the camera? It looked more orange than it did. Yeah, it looks amber.
You can see my face through it. How's my face look through it?
Looks great.
You can see my entire face through it. That's how clear it is.
It looks like the color of the mosquito in Jurassic Park when it was fossilized because it got sucked in through sap.
The OG amber. Yeah, I got you. So Black Raven, yeah, it's out of Redmond, Washington and Woodinville. This is probably their most famous beer. It's award-winning Trickster IPA. It's 6.9%. And it's got really mellow citrus to it. It's not a heavy citrus, but some pine in the hops, which is interesting. I'm not sure if I feel good about that.
You said pine?
Not stoked on pine. Yeah, I mean, I like pine when it comes to
describe
like...
Describe pine to me.
A gin and tonic. Like pine needles, like a gin and... Yeah, oh. Yeah, gin.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's not like overwhelming with the beer, but it's a little hint of it, and it gives it a little sharp freshness. I love pine, like I love gin and tonics because of that. It gives it almost minty, but not earthy mint, you could say. Hmm. But it contrasts with the citrus and the tonic very well. And this is kind of trying to go for the same thing. It has a citrus feel to it and a little bit of pine there for that freshness. But yeah, the pine's a small part of it, but it's definitely there. And I actually like it more now than when we first started the podcast and we tried it. I think my palate's grown a little bit over the years, and I could definitely drink this. I would order this now. I probably wouldn't buy a six pack of it, you know.
Yeah,
but I'd have it at a bar.
Oh, nice. Yeah. That's good. That's shows you're growing as a person when you change your
in more ways than one.
Your beer palate grows.
Yeah, I'm a growing boy. So that's our beverage break now. Now let's get into Black Widow first before we have TK on and talk Loki. So Black Widow came out. What you say you saw it on your birthday? Was it in theaters? Was it at home? What was the ambiance?
So. I got to watch it at home. Disney Plus gave you the option to pay for it either through their app, or you can go watch in the movie theater. And I mean, Amber and I, she bought me a Bose TV speaker, so we got to get the surround sound with the bass and just kind of,
nice.
You know, we bought the popcorn, you know, we got the icy, all the things that I get at a movie theater. That's how we watched it. It's just in front of our big TV with a surround sound system. And I was happy. That was actually quite enjoyable that way for me. Don't get me wrong. There's nothing about missing out a good movie, but I mean, it was kind of that was the first week the state opened up all the way, right? It was right. Perfect timing for, it's like our state and Disney were like talking, you know, like we're going to open up the full state for this movie. So
for Black Widow.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I actually had plans to see it in theaters, but they fell through. So I didn't have anybody to go with, and I didn't want to go by myself. And so I did watch it at home as well. Actually today, earlier on the couch, I got back from the wedding, laid down and just watched it, Black Widow. And, I was, not prepared to fall in love, but you know, here we are once again. Florence Pugh, you got my heart. So thanks a lot for that. No, I really enjoyed it, man. I mean, I don't think I have anything crazy to say about Black Widow. It was, you know, it was really well done. It was directed by Kate Shortland.
Yeah.
And it is a pure thrill ride with great acting, in my opinion. Great execution of the fight scenes. Like, you would think you'd get sick of that leg lock around the head rotating flip that she does, but it's just so cool to see, and the camera angles they use it for. And David Harbour's character was just hilarious, which he knew he was going to be lovable. And the whole family dynamic going through it was interesting. And for those that don't know, this takes place post-Civil War, pre-Infinity War?
Yes, right after when she's on the lam after Civil War.
Right, so she's on the run, so she has no Avengers with her in this. This is just her own solo run. And I was enticed the entire time. I thought the action was going to – I knew the action was going to be great. I liked the entire, you know, Red Room thing. I wish they went a little darker with it, with the Red Room. I feel like it was kind of,
I thought they were, you know, going light. To, the way they made it sound like, and all the training sequences they showed, you know, of her growing up.
Yeah.
I didn't see any of that.
Yeah, they showed that, right, they showed that in the trailer, I thought.
That's what I,
Or at least, and I, it must have been cut out or whatever. Maybe it was too dark, but, like, that's what I was kind of hoping for, mm-hmm. So that's my only real complaint is I feel like they missed an opportunity there, and that's just, I don't know if that's Disney being Disney or if that's just they thought it wasn't good for the storyline, but yeah, that was, I missed out on the Red Room a little bit. It was all kind of like post Red Room. I really liked her sister Yelena, as I already mentioned. I'm in love with her now, and she's also great in Midsommar, obviously, but I really thought it was well done. I don't know, what were your thoughts?
I quite enjoyed it. I mean, the girls were kicking some ass, and they were getting their ass kicked. I mean, Scarlett Johansson's stunt double was probably bruised from toe to scalp because
she got fucked up.
She was getting thrown around. She was fighting all the Black Widows herself.
All the Widows.
Yeah, I mean, and I thought that was great. I loved David Harbour. I was talking to Amber and I were talking during the movie, and I was like, David Harbour's like, if this movie was going to fail at any point, he was like bringing it up the whole time, you know, with mm-hmm. his Red Guardian character. There is a difference in some storylines from the comic book, of course, you know.
I was going to ask you about that because he was a love interest of her.
Yeah, he was a love interest at one point. Instead of a father figure, I think I was talking to Amber. I'm like, okay, right off the bat, you're starting to see some of the changes, you know. Mm-hmm. Taskmaster was kind of one of the worst parts for me. They kind of ruined one of the most iconic villains. There was actually a debate in the comic book store about that. And how
I would like to talk about that with you.
Yes, yes. And so, but other than that, I mean, the graphics, the movie was great. It was high packed action from beginning to end, and Scarlett Johansson made me sad that she announced that she wasn't going to do another Black Widow. I totally agree with you. Florence Pugh is an amazing actress. I mean, I've seen her before in some other stuff that we've talked about. I loved her in Fighting with the Family, you know, the wrestling movie where she likes a biography of one of the wrestlers, Paige, WWE.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Yeah, so she's in that movie. But her character as well was funny. I mean, just trying to do the poses thing made me laugh so hard.
I thought she was fucking hilarious. Yeah, yeah. Like, her and David Harbour's characters carried this movie, in my opinion, and she was so funny. Like, yeah, the making fun of her pose, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And, like, when she's flying in the helicopter, she just has all these little ones. This would be an awesome way to die.
Yeah, yeah.
This would be a not-so-awesome way to die when she's on the table.
Just the conversations, right, were great. The conversations between her and Scarlett, particularly because they start morphing into, like, a sisterly love thing. And, you know, when she's talking about her vest and she's like, yeah, you like my vest? It's got so many pockets and, you know. I think and that's how I think sisters talk, you know. At least that's how my sisters talk. But, I quite enjoyed it.
Let's talk about Taskmaster. So what is the original origin of Taskmaster, and why were you disappointed with this portrayal?
Taskmaster is one of the most badass villains out there because he can literally mimic anything that anybody can do fighting style-wise. Like, he gives Spider-Man a hard time. And if you play Spider-Man the game that came out in 2018... he's in there.
Yeah, you fight Taskmaster. He's like he sets challenges for you, right? And he's like executing.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And in the comic books, he trains other people in fighting styles, and you know, his mimic, I guess, prowess is like unbelievable. And they kind of minimized Taskmaster a little bit in this. Taskmaster's kind of like a sneaky assassin too sometimes, and it definitely was not the storyline of the headmaster's daughter being controlled and changed. That's definitely not the right storyline there. But I mean, and the thing that kind of I think that threw me off is they didn't really have to do that. I mean, I understand getting Black Widow getting red on her ledger, but it's not like they had to bring that person back to revenge, you know, for Taskmaster. You could have put the actual Taskmaster involved. But yeah, that's kind of, you know, the only goofy thing for me. But again, it was great.
But what you're saying is, like, besides the fact that it was the daughter of Dracoff, she did mimic the abilities of everybody she fought.
She did.
I thought she was a pretty badass. Like, when she was in the scene, I was intrigued. Like, the fighting scenes were awesome. Her outfit was dope. The skull face was sick. And she didn't die. And spoilers, she didn't die. So she is still out there. So the abilities are there. It's a girl instead of a guy, but she's still a savage. Like, what's to say that she can't continue on in the MCU and be that villain that you're hoping for?
I think I'm not saying that she can't. Maybe they'll do something great with her in the future. You know, she goes toe to toe with Captain America. Or I'm now saying she, but Taskmaster goes toe to toe with Captain America. I'm not saying she will. I'm just saying the portrayal of the way it occurred in this movie was rough.
So you don't like that she's a minion, like she was being controlled. You want her to be more independent and
should be more badass. I felt like she wasn't badass enough. Like, it didn't matter if it was like a female or not. By the way, it's the fact that, you know, just wasn't able to, like, she wasn't scary to me, you know, or was it, you know, over the top killer. And it wasn't there for me, but I get it. I mean, to me, the storyline followed Black Widow and her sister and the family. That to me was a story, not Taskmaster being the villain. So
for sure.
But yeah, that's the only part
for sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what do you think about the end, post-credit scene? She's given a hit, and it's Hawkeye.
Yeah, there's going to be a TV show, right? And, is this the first time a movie, like, leads into a TV series coming out? Like, is that the first time for that? I mean, because it was really,
all the Marvel series have kind of been that, if you think about it. But this is just another continuation of that, I guess.
I guess my thing, I guess what I'm saying is it, this is actually planned. You know, they use this movie to kind of put into this TV series coming out. I thought it was a little bit weird. You got to see, now I can't remember her name, but she was in Falcon and Winter Soldier.
Julia Lois Dreyfus. Yep.
And it sounds like to me she's putting together the Dark Avengers, which is an alternate Avengers, obviously. And you get to see, like, different versions of, like, Captain America, which would be the U.S. agent, different versions of Black Widow. They might be trying to go after Hawkeye because his daughter can be Hawkeye, you know, different versions of everybody. So I think that's kind of what it led me to. But
that makes sense.
Yeah. Other than that, I mean, it was just kind of, I mean, it's never ending, I guess, with Marvel. They can go forever. So I'm happy about that. That's all I care about.
Yeah. Hopefully they do.
Yeah.
Okay. So a Dark Avengers is cool. I'm about that because I saw a YouTube video that said that it's going to be revealing a new team in the post credits, and it didn't. So that makes sense if that's like the start of the new team.
Yeah, my Dark.
But U.S. Agent is the start of the new team if you think about it.
Yeah, yeah. My Dark Avengers book, the first appearance of Dark Avengers, the leader of it was Norman Osborn. He becomes the Iron Patriot. And that book, that book actually skyrocketed a little bit too. I gotta look for it, but it's kind of a good thing.
I'm into that.
Yeah, it follows the Siege storyline. You've heard me talk about this before. The Siege storyline, where Ares gets messed up by Sentry, you know, killed, and Iron Patriot knocks down, basically brings Thor to Earth, you know, the Asgardian, you know, realm to the planet Earth, which we already saw it fall. So I have a feeling they might be following the storyline a little bit too, which makes me very happy because we're going to see Hercules, so
the
right?
Siege is... Yeah, they're still haven't casted it. We're trying to promote our boy John Gabris to get that role.
I have a feeling they might be kind of pulling from this storyline, and it's one of my favorite storylines. Maybe we should do a episode on it.
We're bouncing on our shoulders together. That means we're going to do it. Yep. All right. So how long is the Siege? Is it like
So it's obviously what we call like a blockbuster story arc that's done during the summer. It's a couple books that are mixed in. But the main storyline is 6 books. It's drawn by Oliver Coipel, which is an amazing artist. And if I remember right, let me actually double check that. Brian Michael Bendis writes that. And he's the guy who created Miles Morales and the Ultimate Spider-Man. So
let's go.
Hopefully yeah, that can be let's what we get to see in the movies. Miles Morales.
Let's do that book.
I really want to see him.
Yeah, as long as it's not fucking Jaden Smith.
All right, probably not.
What would you give Black Widow?
Ooh, Black Widow. I'm going to give Black Widow an 8.9.
Wow. Okay. 8.9.
Yeah, I mean, the Taskmaster aside, I enjoyed Scarlett Johansson's performance. She really kicked butt in this movie. Like, I really would love her to come back. I mean, it's really starting to kill my my late 20s and my early 30s, losing all these movie stars and the MCU. Yeah. So
it's hard to watch them go.
Yeah, but I love David Harbour. I'm excited for season 4 of Stranger Things. Because he's on there,
mm-hmm.
And
he's in the Russia.
He is in Russia. I guess you get to see more of his origin story. Obviously, Florence Poe has been on other stuff, but I think this is going to take her career to another level.
And I'm here for it.
Yep. Yeah. And 100%. She's a great singer, by the way. Look her up, her YouTube videos and singing. It's pretty cool. And she's English, so of course she's got that like extra.
She's a goddess.
Yep.
She's a goddess. All right. Well, I gave it an 8.5.
Oh, nice.
I thoroughly enjoyed it. I thought it was a fun action movie. The Taskmaster, I thought, was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
I get what you're saying, though, from the storyline and the comics.
Yeah, yeah.
I just really wanted that Red Room. I really wanted like almost like a drive feel to it, you know, like a just like a weird synthy red colors, dark
we thought we were going to get that. I think this is why we thought we were going to get it.
I know. So that's what I was hoping for. So that gives us a 8.7 overall. Let's see what Rotten Tomatoes gave it. Have you already looked it up?
I have not. I was looking at, I had Loki all set up.
Rotten Tomatoes gave an 81.
Okay, okay.
So that might be the lowest Marvel movie we've seen.
No.
Especially after the first couple of weeks.
Hulk's
below that, but.
Captain Marvel's at 69 or something like that.
Oh, it is. Yeah, yeah. It was hot when it came out, though. So that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like, this might drop further if it.
I don't know why people. I mean, the movie was great. I think the only thing that can hold me up on this was the fact that it's so late, and it's a prequel.
Yeah, it gave it. So Rotten Tomato critics gave it an 81, and the audience score is a 92. So the critics were more critical. If we have a encapsulating consensus, it says Black Widow's deeper themes are drowned out in all the action, but it remains a solidly entertaining standalone adventure that's rounded out by a stellar supporting cast. So they feel like it was just an action popcorn, but that's what it was, and it was well done, and it was well executed, and great acting.
That's the purpose of it, I think. So yeah. I don't think there was no hitting agenda. There was no trying to reach a wider audience, unless the Red Room stuff was part of that.
The Red Room might be,
but yeah, it didn't feel like it. So I mean, the helicopter scene was one of the best scenes I've seen in a long time.
With the avalanche,
yeah, and David Harbour just literally just struggling the whole freaking time.
Complaining.
The Red Guardian. Yeah. So I think that was really great. And yeah, I mean, again, the Taskmaster was a really low point for me, but other than that, it was great.
Right on. Well, we're going to go into Loki with TK, Thomas Kellogg. But before we do that, we'll take a quick commercial break. And we're back, and we have fan favorite and my personal best friend, I'm pretty sure, TK Ukulele, Thomas Kellogg. How you doing, man? Good to see you.
I'm doing great, fam. How are you guys?
Dude, so good. So good to have you back on the mic, bro. It's been too long.
It is.
You've been busy, man. Following you on IG, you've been doing a lot. You've been doing a lot of cool shit, it sounds like. What you been up to?
I've been doing a lot of filming, like less TK Ukulele stuff. I mean, I did put out a towel. That was like a big thing that was going on. I put out a TK Ukulele towel.
I got one. My brother got one.
For real? Take pictures with it, man. I'll repost that shit.
Fuck yeah. He said he went to the bathroom and forgot he had it, and it was hanging over his shower, and he thought there was somebody like in his shower. He's like, oh, shit. It's just your naked
That's
ass.
That's so cool. That is so cool. There's like, I think like 10 people bought towels, but it's so cool that they're just out there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got my towels. I've been doing a lot of filming, like DP work and writing. I wrote a movie with the dumb bitch of the internet. You guys know who those are?
We listen to their music. You play their stuff. So you wrote a movie. What's it called? What's it about?
It's called The Dumb Bitch Movie. We might change it to
Internet Movie.
right now it's called Dumb and Dumber Bitches. So
What's it about?
And it's really good. It's a road movie about the guys, and they're trying to get their music back and trying to save a dog at the same time. It's a beautiful story. It's a little Harold and Kumar meets fucking Dumb and Dumber meets all that shit, you know? It's that kind of movie.
Meets Keanu. I love that.
Meets Keanu meets Gummo. Gummo.
The dynamic duo.
You guys ever seen the movie Gummo?
Gummo, no. Mm-hmm.
Harmony Korine, you guys ever seen the movie Hoop Dreams?
I don't think so. Is that no? I'm thinking about Basketball Diaries.
It's the most real movie.
I'm looking it up
you'll
now.
Ever see Gummo? It's a lot. It's gonna have Gummo vibes. I know that. It's gonna be weird. This weird universe.
Okay. Are you gonna use some kind of tinted filters when you record like different colors and stuff to make it add to the flavor?
I want to use like some actual old cameras, like actual fucking. if I could, you know. But yeah, I guess we'll vintage. Fudge it if we have to. Yeah, go vintage. Like actually, like let the people taste it. You know, with gumbo, baby, Harmony Korine. He's all
so
he's fucked up.
Is that the movie you're assistant directing on as well? You said you're doing, you got an AD.
No. That's, I'm assistant directing on a horror film. Nuwachek brother film. Yeah.
Nuwachek?
Yeah. So.
Kyle?
Kyle's producing it. His brother's directing it, and I'm assistant directing, and I'm fucking super stoked. I've been producing too with him, like on the side.
Yeah.
But like, it's been fun. It's really cool producing an AD in something that's like a narrative. Like, it's really nice to do that.
Right.
Yeah. And for those out there that don't know, Kyle Newcheck's Carl from Workaholics, who is good buddies with TK. So that's fucking exciting. So what's the responsibilities of an AD? Like, what do you do on the set?
It's kind of like you do everything that is not creative to allow the person to allow the director to be creative. You know what I'm saying? Like kind of,
yeah,
you dot all the I's and cross all the T's and sure. kind of run the ship, you know, like make sure people are in places. So like people are in places, people have makeup on, people got the lighting's going good. Like I'm talking to all the departments while he's focusing on one department at a time, you know?
Yeah.
I like to consider it like a fucking general, you know?
I like it. I'd fall in line, you know? I'd fall in line if you got me going there. So how long have you been filming for? What's the timeline on this? Like, what do we have a story?
Oh, we start filming. I mean, it's a horror film in the woods. I'll say that much.
Horror film in the woods.
It's pretty cool. It's a low budget horror film in the woods, and I'm excited about the low budget, if that makes sense.
Oh yeah.
There's like a bunch of no-name actors, which I love even more because it's like, there's really like this vibe of camaraderie, and it feels like everybody is like there's a buzz, you know?
Yeah.
Just it's really cool.
Yeah, it's like Sam Raimi and Evil Dead, kind of like that's how.
Yeah.
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 Low budget. They made up their own camera rolls, you know?
Yes. Yeah. It's going to have that freedom. Like, it's not going to have that big old price tag next to it that you don't take chances.
I like right. that.
We did this thing. We did this thing called photo boarding. So instead of, you guys know about storyboards for films, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
We did this thing called photo boardings that Kyle learned about from Brandon Dermer. Brandon Dermer's like a music video director, and he just directed Kyle's last low budget film. And what he does is he shoots the whole movie with pictures beforehand, like him and his girlfriend or whoever is around. They'll shoot all the shots, and so instead of like, so like if people are talking, like this guy's talking to this guy, like they'll shoot it in the spot if they can. And then instead of having their storyboards drawn, they're just looking at these pictures. So it's easy to walk into the exact place that they did the photo board for. And I just thought it was so, so ingenious. And I don't know how we ever go back to storyboards unless you're doing like VFX shit, you know?
Yeah, that's interesting. So you basically, you shoot it twice. You shoot it with camera, and then you shoot it with the recording. Is that or is it like stand-ins?
I mean,
for
it's stand-ins for the photos, and it's gotcha. Like not lit right. It's like done quickly. Like the only thing that is the blocking. Like you're kind of getting out the blocking, getting out the angles you want, and you're getting it. You're seeing how you want to live in the space that you're in. Maybe even figure out the angles, and then you know. And we did all this in like a day and a half. Like. It was okay. It was so smart. Like, I can't wait to see this book that we got, and it's just like, okay, what's next? Cross that off. It's so efficient. I love it.
That's pretty cool.
Hell yeah. Well, gonna be stoked to have that, have you back on to talk about it when it comes out so we can watch it. That's gonna be fucking fun.
Yeah. That'd be dope.
Right on, man.
I'd love to be an extra. That's kind of like my dream. I'm short, so I can't be like a main actor, but I can definitely be an extra.
We'll make all the other actors look taller.
Well, that's probably true. But I was thinking, because I'd be like, I'd be a great extra in like Star Wars, because you throw me like an Ewok suit or something, or like, you know.
How tall are you?
I'm only 5'2", almost 5'3".
5'2". Damn, bro.
Yeah.
Little, whenever we go places like Comic Cons, I just put him in my front pocket.
Nah, so I don't like standing next to Jordan, because Jordan's 6'3".
Are you 6'3", Jordan?
I'm 6'3".
Yeah.
This is crazy, man, because I thought you guys were the exact same height.
Like, we are on screen.
I got some...
Y'all got some, like, this is Lord of the Rings shit where, like, you know, we got that forced perspective shit going on.
It's all blocking, yeah. JR sits on a booster seat when he records, and I lower my chair. So we're all at the same height.
Yeah, I do have a big, like, presence, so I get that sometimes too, though.
I swear you're about to say cocked. A big dick. We all thought you were about to have that.
I am packing.
You had that long dramatic pause, and you wanted us to put that in our brain.
The world thought it was coming.
It's for effect. It's for... I have to pause because I have to make it up somewhere. Just that long pause.
Yeah, he's 5'2", but he weighs 250 pounds.
Just like Wolverine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he has a very long, very, very long.
Dramatic pause.
Pause. Right on, man. Well, super stoked to have you on, and super stoked you're doing so many cool things out in the field. That's fucking exciting, man, and love talking to you about it. But today we are also going to talk about Loki, because you've watched Loki now, and it's all out there.
I watched Loki. Yeah.
And from what I gather, you're pretty excited about it.
Okay, so, I mean, I know what they were trying to do, at least at the beginning. It was like, okay, we're going to do a True Detective type vibe. You know, it felt like it. Felt like that's what we were dropping into. Buddy cop. And I was all for it. Like, the first episode, I'm like, this is dope. Okay. I tell you what, I'm going to fast forward to the end. It's like, so this whole thing was to set up the, you know, the madness, whatever, multiverse of madness. That's what this whole thing was for.
Yeah.
You could tell that that's what this was for, episode 4. Like, they're just setting up a movie. That's all they're doing. setting up a new bad guy, setting up, like, I knew that's the only reason this Loki thing was. And I kind of felt bad, you know, cause I don't know how much Loki changed, like, especially compared to Wanda. They knocked it out the park with WandaVision. Like, that shit was gorgeous. It was beautiful. It was well acted. It wasn't corny, even though there were so many moments that could be corny. Loki kind of got corny for me a little bit.
Okay, interesting take. So you kind of lost steam towards the end.
I lost a little bit of steam. I mean, I felt like they could have delved deeper into the existentialism of it, you know, especially because, like, we're talking about different pathways you could take, you know, like different versions of yourself, different all this. I felt like they could have done more with that instead of just kind of making it like a joke, like there's a kid version of him, there's an older version of him, there's all this, there's an alligator version of him, there's a big old black dude version of him. It's like, let's just get different looking versions of him. I mean, there's a female version of him. It's like, what does he take away from each one of these? You know, like the younger version of him, I feel like they just threw him away and he just left.
Like, what's the younger version? He fucking killed Thor, and I wanted to hear how.
They just threw that they threw that shit away.
Yeah.
Like, because it's a cool line. Oh, I killed Thor. And then it's like, oh, this gravitas. And this motherfucker just leaves. He's not even there for, like, the big fight. It's just the old dude, who I thought did a great job.
Dude.
But, like, Richard, a lot of missed moments.
I can't remember his name. Richard something. Yeah. Richard Kimble. That was cool. It's fucking... I really liked Eliath. I thought that was a really cool beast. That smoke monster that was just devouring everything. But that was pretty cool.
I liked that, too. Very much Lost style, like, whole thing, Loki was like, it felt like Lost. Like, the next episode, you're going to find out this new mystery.
I was actually thinking that, too. I got Lost vibes, like, the smoke monster, obviously, but also, like, they're kind of misplaced, and they don't know where they're at or what's real. And, like,
yes.
It's very, got a lot of Lost vibes, and also kind of meets, like, Doctor Who with all, like, the... transportation to different dimensions, the door even, like, is the telephone booth or whatever. So yeah, I think it pulled from a lot of those shows, which
yeah,
I don't know. I'll go in my piece, and JR, you can give yours after that, but I thought it was really good, and I knew going into it what it was going to be. It was going to be a 6-episode setup for the phase 4, and I kind of thought it was going to be really witty and fun. I was excited to see Tom Hiddleston and Owen Wilson kind of paired together. And when they were on screen, they were magnetic. I thought that they did
loved
a freaking
it.
Great job. Owen Wilson's just the best. And I did think Tom Hiddleston got a little cheesy. I mean, I don't know if he's ever done more hair flips in his life. And like dramatic stands, and like it was so intense. And like I also didn't really buy the relationship between him and the Sylvie. I mean, I bought it, but I don't buy Tom Hiddleston's Loki just changing his heart that much, that dramatically, to where he's like a good guy all of a sudden. Yeah.
Especially since he's fucking himself. Like he kissed himself, right?
See, and if he did that, like if they like focus on the vain side of that, to where he's only in love with himself because that's how vain he is, like that would have been funny and I would have bought into that more. But the fact that he didn't even really acknowledge that, I thought was kind of like a missed opportunity.
It was a bunch of half thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah, and I did really enjoy what's his name, Jonathan Majors, who plays the He Who Remains.
I did.
I thought he fucking killed it. I did not love the finale because I thought the ending was just kind of like meh. But it was so interesting, and I thought that to have a guy talking in a scene and basically laying out the entire plot for like 40 minutes and have it being like enticing and exciting. I thought he did such a good job of that. I'm excited to have a charismatic, self-aware, ultra villain, which I think is what he's going to become eventually in this phase four. Like instead of just like the ominous Thanos, it's going to be somebody who you actually kind of side with, and you hear him like, you want to see him. He's excited about what he's doing. I think that's kind of exciting. But all in all, I thought it was pretty well executed. I get what you're saying though. It's just a step. It's not an actual on its own. It's not a standalone like great series. It's just like a step to the next message.
Yeah.
What do you think, JR?
You know, I enjoyed the movie. I mean, you do know that he plays
It's a show. So.
Show. I do like the show. Sorry. Jonathan Majors, you know he becomes Kang, right? I mean, and then the Council of Kangs, and that can lead.
They just never called him Kang. He said.
I know. They just showed this. They statue. I mean, there's so many things that are involved with that. I think that was pretty cool. I did like.
Look at that pour.
You know, look at that. I like the last three better than the first three. And I mean,
really?
Yeah.
You liked it. You liked the second half more. I thought.
Yeah, I like the second half more. There's just so more. There was more comic book references in the second half than the first half. You know.
Such as? Can you inform us? Because me and TJ are the most comic book.
I mean, just all the Lokis alone. Those are different versions from different storylines. I mean, the kid Loki is from when we talked about this a little bit, where he dies in the siege and he comes back as a kid. And then he becomes a teenager in a storyline. And then you see the old Loki, you know, the grumpy with the cape and the just seeing those. I mean, it reminded me of the Loki where it's Thor versus Hulk, and where Loki basically mind melts Hulk and takes over his body to fight Thor, and actually sends Thor to hell. So maybe that's what he was referencing to kill Thor. Which is there's all kinds of things like that. The Kang thing has always been really interesting because he's like a celestial being, and he can. There's an Avengers storyline where he's like in the mix a little bit. Do you guys know who the Watcher is?
Yes.
You're going to see the What If stuff, right?
Big ol' head.
Yeah. And you see the What If animated story coming on. Well, the Kang basically does what the Watcher doesn't, which is interfere. The Watcher is not supposed to interfere. He's supposed to just kind of see what's going on, even though every once in a while he does. But Kang is like, I need to control everything. And that's why he's like the ultimate villain, because he can kind of manipulate even Thanos at times, because he does, I don't like that storyline, let me fix it, or I don't like how that works. So I know they're going to make a season two, right? At the end of that, they stamp season two's coming. So, I mean, is it in?
So is that going to be after the movies, probably, I guess?
Possibly.
Well, yeah, Kang is only credited so far, to my knowledge, in Jonathan Majors is going to be in Ant-Man and Wasp Quantumanium, but that's not coming out till 2023. So I have a hard time imagining he's not going to make his appearance in any movie for two more years after that big reveal. I feel like he's going to have to pop up.
Spider-Man's at the end of this year, right? And that has a multiverse element with Doctor Strange. And Doctor Strange and WandaVision, Wanda, is that this year or next year?
Next year. the Multiverse of Madness.
So
yeah, that's next year.
We're gonna
I think Spider-Man's the big one this year.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about the multiverse. There's a lot of different storylines. I mean, Miles Morales comes from a different Spider-Man comes from a different universe, you know. So
I mean, they did Spider-Verse already, so we got a feel for that a little bit.
Yeah,
yeah, and I dug that. Yeah. That was perfect.
So I'd love to see a movie version of Miles.
Yeah.
So is it like, it's different worlds. It's not like they're not winking at the audience like, this is a movie, this is a movie. It's like, we're legitimately in different storylines.
It could be. I mean, I think right now, I mean, that Loki was a different story, different time. I mean, he was in a different, he came out of, but I read an article about how, did this story Loki cancel what happened with Thanos? And I don't think so. I think it's just another portion of, you know, of life, like in another timeline, another universe.
Oh, so Iron Man might still be alive in this whatever.
Could be. Iron Man. Wow. I know Scarlett Johansson said she's not going to do Black Widow again, but I've heard there's some Captain America stuff coming. So, I mean, we could be seeing, let's say they're gone for 5 or 6 years, and then all of a sudden you start seeing the first cast come back around, you know, do some.
I'm sure they'll make cameos, but they're all pretty tired of doing it, I imagine.
Yeah, I mean, maybe like a movie here or there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a decade, man. That's crazy.
Yeah, and they made their money, I'm sure. So I just want to revisit Kang a little bit, because I was surprised by his portrayal, and kind of confused a little bit. Like, from what I understand, he's a Nexus being, and to my knowledge, that's basically, with all timelines, some characters are there, some aren't, but with Nexus beings, they are literally in every single timeline. Like, they're in every one, so they're like the most prominent characters in these timelines, and he's one of them. But you're saying he's celestial and he's on the level of the Watcher. Now, in the show, he portrayed himself like he was just a variant human being, flesh and blood, that figured out technology early
figured
on,
shit out.
And yeah, so like, is that an accurate portrayal of one of the Kangs, or is he actually more powerful and he was just misleading the Lokis, and he's not just flesh and blood?
I've seen Kang in the comic books like interact with Galactus, like that's how strong Kang. Like, he's
And if he's gonna be a big baddie, he has to be super powerful.
Yeah.
I'm just like, so like, was that just the variant side of him that was the?
I've never read anything with him being like a person, and then finding out, and him being so smart, he figures out there's a multiverse, and then how to jump. I've never read that about him, but maybe that's an origin story, a version of his origin story, you know, where he comes, because Kang is some kind of a being. He's, you know, humanoid. You know, he's not like just some crazy.
Is he blue?
He's got like a blue mask on, yeah, with a helmet.
Okay.
Yeah. So
it's a mask, though.
I think
it's not a skin.
I think it's a mask. I've seen him I've seen it like in his hand before, but I mean, who knows with comics, there's so much, but yeah, I think maybe this might be a movie version. I've never looked too deep into Kang other than that. It's that he's been a piece of crap and manipulated.
Do you know what his powers are?
I've never actually seen him. Like, I'm trying to think of like a battle scene. I've never actually seen him in a battle. I think I've only seen him manipulate things. I've seen him be really great with technology and understand it and make things like ships and stuff like that. But like an actual battle scene, I can't think of anything that I've read that he is. I'm pretty sure he has something, but
how does he manipulate?
Here's his power list. He's a time traveler.
Yep. That one I do.
I listen to a podcast, and apparently he's from the future, and he's theorized to either be the offspring of Mr. Fantastic or Dr. Doom.
Yeah, so he's like a person.
And he uses Dr. Doom's time travel to like his time travel machine or whatever, is what I've heard. So he has time travel, he has genius level intellect, skilled tactician, hand-to-hand combat, resistant to radiation, access to advanced technology, highly advanced battle armor that grants enhanced strength, energy, hologram, force field projection, 30-day supply of air and food. So his armor. So it sounds like he's just basically, he's got equipment. He's not actually, and he's really smart. So he's like, almost like a Batman.
He's like a puppet master kind of
guy. A will-sapping ray gun called Rama Tut.
You're digging into like the comics of like the 70s and
the ones. Yeah, because he went back into the BC times and he was like an emperor of Pharaoh, and the Fantastic Four had to like follow him and kill him or something. But so the fact that he's an offspring of either Reed Richards or Dr. Doom, that means the Fantastic Four have to be coming on the map.
Theorize. Soon, yes, he does. Right? They do fight him a lot. I mean, what I've read is he's out in space. I mean, he's dealing with celestial beings, you know what I mean? Like Galactus, and he's manipulating things to his favor.
But he's small. He's like human size, though, right?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. He's like a regular dude.
So he must just have... He has crazy battle armor, a time-traveling machine, and a ray gun. And he's just out there just wrecking shit. That's actually kind of impressive. If he's able to do that shit with just being human.
He just does it like it's a job.
Yeah.
That's so true.
It's like, all right, time to clock in.
Yeah, he's just like, he got a lunch pail and everything, just ready.
Right on. All right, so TK, you were a little underwhelmed. What would you give it on a scale of 1 to 10, the series?
6.
A 6?
I'm giving it a 6. I was excited for every episode. Like, I did watch it on Wednesday when it came out. Like, I tried to stay up.
Oh, nice.
After I put my kids to sleep, and I was like, all right, I'm going to dig into this. And every single episode, I was like, all right. I mean, yeah, that was cool. I liked Owen Wilson. I guess I didn't like Tom Hiddleston that much. He didn't add anything to the character. Like, you got to unravel stuff with Wanda. And even in Falcon and Winter Soldier, you may not have unraveled it, but you at least got to, like, the friendship. You got to, like, see that grow. With this one, it was just watching Loki in a different place, you know? That's what it kind of felt like.
Yeah. I liked his character more so before he met Sylvie. When he met Sylvie, he got kind of soft. And, again, I feel like they missed the opportunity to make that a vain thing and just actually a love story. Like, who gives a fuck? So I don't disagree with you there. I did give it a 9, though, personally. I thought it was, for what it was trying to execute, I thought I did it really well. And I thought, I'm just really excited for Kang's character. I'm hoping that, like, the dark side of that charisma, I'm excited to see it. Because he was very positive and, like, likable. But you could tell he has another side, obviously, and I'm really excited to see that. But I would give it a 10 if I thought the finale was kind of eh. And the Tom Hiddleston hair flips, I got a little tired of. Just the
yeah,
daggers. JR, what'd you give it, man?
That's funny. You gave it a better score than I would. I mean, I was going to give it like an 8.5. So 8.2 is what I'm going to give it.
8.2?
Yeah.
Okay.
I did one thing I do think that was weird was him kissing himself. I mean, he making out with Sylvie was kind of weird to me. I mean, and there was like, you know, the more articles I read, it sounded like the director really had some agendas too as well, which was really weird to me. You know, the LBGT,
like the LGBT, yeah.
And any
he's the first hero or whatever to be trans.
Yeah,
he's not. Or he likes
binary. Yeah. So I mean, that kind of really kind of threw me off. I mean, that's great stuff. I'm not saying it's not. I'm just saying we've struggled in the past with things that have had an agenda instead of making it for the arts and, you know, making.
Did you? But this wasn't that prominent.
It wasn't. But so which is why I didn't understand.
He's non-binary because he kissed himself.
Because he
is that what we're saying?
He's fluid. Loki can become a girl and a guy. And when Loki
But we can't. But like if I was in this world, because I'm not non-binary, I can only turn into a man.
No, Loki is like a master of like disguise as well, and so when he comes back to life, there's a part just like Thor actually turns like the gods, Norse gods, you know, they change into women, and so they were using that as a reference to him being fluid, a guy, the girl. Plus, he also said he liked men in the, you know, he's dabbled in both basically.
He did say that in the show.
He did say that, yeah, so. And again,
that's cool.
I think if that's great, but anytime you got the director talking about it, then it becomes part of the story. So, I mean, I don't know why she brought it up, and she's not even going to be a part of season 2.
She's not?
No. So,
I didn't know that. Yeah. Okay. I liked her character. I thought her character was badass.
Oh, Sylvie's going to be a part of I don't know about Sylvie. I mean, the director.
Okay. Sylvie, I was like, Sylvie's not going to be in it? That doesn't make sense. Okay, cool. Right on. So that gives us a 7.7. If you look at Rotten Tomatoes score,
it was pretty high.
The critics gave it a 92.
Yeah.
And the audience gave it an 87.
You can't really go that wrong. Damn. It's Marvel. I mean, when's the last time you saw a really low Marvel Rotten Tomatoes?
An 83 is like as low as it goes.
Yeah, I think Captain Marvel was probably still up there. Let me look at them. Just do it for some comparisons.
And Captain Marvel was like known as the worst one or something?
Yeah. Us. Yeah,
I mean, wasn't Iron Man like 3 pretty bad? Didn't they people not like that?
It didn't get very good reviews, but honestly, I hated it at first, and I went and rewatched it, and I actually like it better than Iron Man 2 now. So
it's quite enjoyable.
I loved it when I first saw it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I didn't. I thought it was kind of like, what the fuck's happening? This isn't even the real Mandarin, yada yada. And then the comedy got me in the second time around. It was actually really fucking funny.
Plus, you get to see all the Mark, all the suits, you know, MK48.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to not like, I mean, a Marvel stuff these days. Disney's put so much money into it.
They do such a good job. Yeah. They don't fucking miss on casting. I will say that. They just don't miss. Like, they continue to cast the right people for the right roles.
I mean,
like,
what
Jonathan
about
Majors?
Jonathan Majors, I mean, he's fucking amazing in, what was that show?
Lovecraft Country?
Lovecraft shit. He was great.
I haven't watched it yet.
What about Captain Marvel? Do you think Brie Larson?
I thought Brie Larson was a miscast. I thought Brie Larson.
That is a miscast.
Although I love her. I love her. She's a great actress. Room. She was
great
amazing.
Actress. She's gorgeous. She just has this weird little cockiness.
Wasn't she on 21 Jump Street,
she
the
does.
Second one? Or the first one? That's where I liked her.
She was on the second 21 Jump Street.
Gotcha.
I'm pretty sure.
I mean, she's beautiful. She's very pretty. She's very pretty, but she's... They have this... Do you guys ever watch Charisma on Command?
No.
There's this internet thing called Charisma on Command. It helps you, like, become a cooler guy.
Oh, really?
It teaches you how to be more charismatic. And they did this whole episode about, like, how not to be in, like, a social situation. And it was... They were just taking clips of her.
That makes sense.
It's so sad. Like, it's really bad.
And
I also watched Charisma on Command. Yeah.
I'll have to check that out, too.
Is that why you're getting so charismatic all of a sudden? Like, I can feel the energy over here from the screen.
I mean, you want to talk about it. Like, I watched Charisma on Command, but before Charisma on Command was out, I used to watch, like, footage of gorillas walking around, and I used to try to like be like them. I used to be a bouncer.
What?
So before,
you wanted to imitate
every day
gorillas?
Before, every day before I went to work as a bouncer because I was terrified. You know, I got divorced and I was like, okay, now I'm gonna be a bouncer. I'm like, let's see what we could do. I was terrified. I would watch video of gorillas just walking around the jungle and just be like, okay, everybody's gonna, I'm gonna park the ways.
Okay, scrap the beginning of this episode. This is the new episode. We're starting here. What the fuck, dude? Like, so
yeah, I would do that, and I would go to the beach. No, I don't think so. I used to do that, and I used to go to the beach. Yeah, I used to do that and go to the beach and just run into waves. Just be like, just hold my ground. I'm like, I'm not gonna move. And I would dig my feet into the sand and just be like, just goosh, goosh.
Like Happy Gilmore in the batting cage.
Exactly like Happy Gilmore.
I love it.
I've actually done that before. I've tried to like not let a wave take me back, but I've never watched gorillas on YouTube and tried to imitate their swagger. That's amazing. I'm so happy.
You know, just like I'm gonna walk through this room. I'm gonna walk in the very center of the room. Yeah, they kind of just like boom, because you got the big one on.
Did you drag your knuckles on the ground too? Like,
yeah, I just got held.
I get low. Yeah.
I wouldn't fuck with you if you were a bouncer.
I mean, if someone's like going this low, just like looking at you, that's pretty scary.
Dude, I'd be terrified for you and of you. So, yeah, I love that. Oh fuck. Well, before we let you go, man, did you have any TK ukulele jams you wanted to throw our way? Do you have anything for the audience or?
Hold up.
All right.
It's kind of tradition at this point. Oh, he's got the uke on deck. Of course he does.
Yeah.
Of course he has the baby. Let's go.
I mean, it might not be in tune, but we'll see what's up.
Damn, bro, you're so busy on the sets, you're not even tuning your uke anymore, huh? You're big leagues now.
I lost it all. I was trying to make this uke thing pop, but it was like, it's just not popping yet. It will, though.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, here we go. This one's for Loki, because this is one of his like things.
Oh hell yeah!
Little suffer, little one, made my heart come all undone. Do you love me? Do you suffer, suffer girl?
All right. Yeah. Surfer girl, love it. Beach Boys, yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful.
We love awesome, ending man. Our show. Hey,
you guys are you guys about to talk about fucking Black Widow?
My main bitch, my main squeeze, my girl.
Yeah,
hell yeah, dude.
She pregnant now, absolutely. And Colin Jost. You guys want to talk about Colin Jost really quick?
Oh, you got beef with Colin? I forgot about this. His goddamn forehead.
How the fuck did that happen? How does that happen? You're
still on that, huh?
How did he get Scarlett Johansson?
I don't know.
He doesn't. No, he doesn't.
He's a head comedy writer.
Is he the top? Hold up. Is he in the top 10 of Weekend Update host? Is he in the top 10? And I think there's only been 10.
No.
Is he in the? You know what I'm saying? Like
Bill Hader was one of the best, and then.
I like him better than, was it Colin Quinn? Was that his name?
Colin Quinn had, Colin Quinn was fun.
I'll take Colin Quinn like over Colin him. Quinn.
He was Eric.
I like Jost because he's so goddamn white and, like, proper that Michael Shea and him, like, the dynamic is perfect. But on his own, the dynamic. No, sure.
I will tell you, I saw him.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
Did you
about.
Watch Tom and Jerry? He was awful in that.
Oh, no, who? I didn't see Tom and Jerry.
He's in Tom and Jerry.
He's in the movie.
Yeah, he's he's marrying an Indian lady. Lady and like that lady was super hot and I'm like I don't believe that at all.
What? Damn. Yeah, I see. What? God, what's what happened? Is it? Well, yeah. Does he have a? Is he have a long?
Is he? Does he have a dramatic? Pause? Yeah, does he have a long
pause?
Huge pause.
Does he have a huge pause?
He probably does. Probably does.
Huge, I don't know, man. But
hefty pause.
I forgot Scarlett Johansson was like. As pretty as she was until she, like I was scrolling through Instagram and they did this. She was like wearing these black leather pants and I'm like, oh my gosh, that's what we fell in love with. Mm-hmm. That's that Lost in Translation shit. Mm-hmm. That's that booty we all, that America fell in love with.
Yeah.
That's how she was introduced to the world. Was her just laying on a bed in panties.
That's true.
I know she was like a kid in other things.
Yeah, she was a kid in the movie called Just Cause. So that was kind of hard.
Yeah, but like I'm saying, like as a woman, role. As a sex symbol, it's like you could have if that was your thing for her, JR. That's cool, but like, as a sex symbol, her coming out party was Lost in Translation.
It's not like that. I will.
You know, Bill. You know, Bill Murray hit that. You know, he did.
All I could say is I
hope so.
Yeah, me too. I could say is that I wish her and Chris Evans because they're best friends and they get along and they laugh and he is pretty. For almost too pretty for a lot of
that
ladies,
would make more sense.
But that would probably
make a lot more sense. A
lot more sense.
It would.
But he's dating Lily James too. So I mean, he's that guy's.
Who's Lily James?
Cinderella.
Yeah, I don't know
she was in that movie Cinderella.
Oh, she's beautiful.
Yeah, so I think. Yeah, I mean
that's more equal.
Okay. Yeah, it's tough, man.
He's doing okay.
Yeah,
if you look on screen, okay. So if you're sitting in a movie theater, I'm pretty sure Colin Jost sat with Scarlett Johansson. And watched fucking Endgame, okay? And you're looking at every motherfucker on the screen. And if you're Colin Jost, you're like, wow, I am like so far behind every single person on this screen. Right?
It's not all about muscles.
I don't...
All right? Sometimes it's just what's on the inside.
Fucking take the muscles away. I'm talking, he got a big old fucking horse mouth, too. He has a big horse mouth, too. Send this to him. I don't give a fuck. Like... I'll go straight off face. If we'll just do headshots, this motherfucker loses. I don't get it. And he's not that funny either. He's not Paul Rudd funny.
Oh, no. I mean, Paul Rudd. That's another delicious.
Okay, so like Scarlett Johansson could get Paul Rudd.
That's true.
He's spoken for him.
Yeah, he's been married quite a while.
Yeah. You know, it's whatever. You guys got to talk about the movie. I just wanted to get that.
No, that's okay. We love it.
I'm glad you got that out.
Got
that
TK take. Got to get the TK.
I would suggest watching it though, because I have always been in love with ScarJo, and I kind of found a new love in Black Widow, and it's
the other girl.
Oh, Florence Pope.
She's amazing in Midsommar, and she's amazing in Little Women. She's a great actress.
Yep.
And
I think she's so fucking good. God, I love that movie.
Didn't she do a wrestling?
Makes you want to get burnt up in a bear costume. That's what I would do for her.
I would do it. I would do it. I would sit there and I would be fucking motionless, and it'd be all worth it. And she fucks shit up in that movie, so highly recommend.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll check it out. Hey, you guys, party on!
Hey, brother. Great seeing you. Yep. Keep doing big things, man. I'm so happy for you, and we're excited to watch you fly and to interview you every once in a while along the way.
Yeah,
man.
Definitely. And
we'll do it. We'll do it.
And let me know when you want me to be an extra in one of your movies. I'll fly down
there. Of course, bro. Of course. When I need like a step stool or something like that.
I'll just pick something small. Maybe I can like do like a stunt double for a kid or something. I don't know.
That's cool. Yeah. And just throw you off a train.
Yeah. That'd be great.
Okay.
Let's fucking do it, bro.
Okay, cool. All right,
see
you guys.
Take it easy. We're back, and before we close out, we would like to do a quick comic stock talk. What do you have for our listeners to invest in if you want to build your comic stock equity? So just so you guys know, if you haven't listened to it before, JR makes some recommendations on some comics that are potentially going to have a big uptick in value with the upcoming movies. And if you want to invest and buy some now and then hold on to them, you might be able to flip them later for some big bucks. So JR, what's on the market today?
Yeah, so there are various books for, obviously, Loki. You want Thor 245, you know. It's the first appearance of He Who Remains, obviously the creator of the Timekeepers. And it's only, you know, it's probably around $100 to get. Maybe if you can find a lesser copy, you could probably get that for a cheaper price. And it sounds like there's going to be more of that character involved, so maybe that book will climb. You can get Avengers 267, which is the first appearance of the Council of Kangs, and that actually is a really much lower book. You could probably get that for about $50, maybe $40. Found that really good. And then on a two personal things, the Nice House on the Lake number 1 came out about 2 months ago. It's a DC Black Label book. Basically, it's the end of the world. Looks like possibly the devil wanted to did this Joan of Arc thing and brought these various people to the house to save them from the apocalypse. And the book has grown in purchases of copies. So maybe they're thinking a movie or something might be coming out of that. And I have the first two books. They're only on issue 2 right now. And let me tell you, it's pretty creepy. It's a horror book. So I do recommend that. And then on a personal note, I was taking a book that Jordan and I, our first investment as a couple, I mean, as a podcast team. We started after WonderCon. We really wanted to kind of dabble in the comic book investment, and we invested in a book called Superman number 4, which has the first appearance of Bloodsport, which is going to be on the Suicide Squad, and we bought that book for $18. Looking right now just at eBay and some other sites to be able to purchase it, it is at $40. So hey-o. We have doubled our money in about a month. So you're gonna win all of them? No. Are you gonna win some of them? Yes. And it's fun to watch your money grow. And just when the movie comes out, we are going to sell that book, because who's going to want to watch? No one's going to get a Bloodsport movie independent. But we may have just doubled our money, and just by being a little bit of cognizant of what's coming out and purchasing it and taking that, what I call a calculated risk. And we made a little bit of dough on that.
Hell yeah. Well, that was 100% JR and zero of me, besides half of the financial backing. So thank you for that, JR. And that is what we're looking for, or that's what we're here for you guys, is to help you build, you know, some equity in an investment style that's a little more fun, at least to me, than just looking at fucking business acronyms and trying to invest in one that's going to make a huge hit. So thanks for that information, JR. Anything you want to plug before we sign off?
Well, I'm actually going to plug myself, actually. I'm doing some art again. It's been a while. I just someone asked me to draw on a comic book. My friend Jeremy, he shops at the Action City store. And it got me really kind of the juices flowing. So if anybody has any requests, let me know. I'll draw something for you. If not, then I'll just kind of pick my own stuff. But look to see some of my art on our page.
I'll send you some pictures of me.
Good.
For you to draw.
That should be pretty. I've drawn you before. I can do it again.
I'm not posing this. Well, as always, you know, we want to give a shout out to our mothership, Action City Comics. They are the lifeblood of this podcast, and we support them, and Doug's our boy. So go and shop there and fetch away whenever you get a chance. And you can always find us at Hop Heroes Pod on Instagram and Twitter. Tell your friends, like, and subscribe. I'm trying to continue to grow here. And thank you guys so much for listening this week. Catch you on next week.
Yep.